If you can study at any place, at any time, and at any pace, and from any device, that is what Telecom Academy calls real convenience. And I hope you are enjoying it from your favorite channel. Welcome to bipolarization transistor as a switch as well as an amplifier. Your presenter on your channel is Marufu Motion, and as usual, my email address motionmarufu68@gmail.com, on WhatsApp +2637175358666. Guys, if you haven't subscribed, don't hesitate to hit the subscribe button. You can also like, you can also share, and you can also comment. It is you who makes Telecom Academy great, wherever you are, enabling you to study from any device, at any pace, and at any time. Let us enjoy BJT. Guys, by the end of this presentation, you should be able to, number one, describe suitable diagrams to explain how a BJT transistor can be used as a switch. You must also be able to draw the circuit diagram of a transistor connected in common emitter configuration mode and state the relationship between input and output signals. Then the third objective, you must be able to demonstrate using load line the effect of operating a transistor near saturation, at near cutoff, and also at the center of the load line. Then you must be able to state factors that affect the Q point of a BJT transistor. Just four of them and you are done. Let us proceed. A transistor can be as a switch, and we know that a switch is used to turn on or turn off circuits. So we want to see how a transistor can be used as a switch and also the relationship between the input and the output. And we are saying transistors are widely used, and this we know in digital logic circuits. We'll be covering digital electronics later, and they are also used in switching applications. The voltage levels alternate between high and low when we turn on a switch. In other words, the voltage across a switch is zero when it is turned on, and it is equal to the supply voltage when it is turned off, hence high and low. When we are using a transistor as a switch, when it is on, it will be operating in the saturation mode, and when it is off, it will be operating in the cutoff mode. This transistor is a BJT and an NPN type, and it is connected in common emitter configuration mode CE. Let's have a look at the relationship between the output and the input. This is our pulse, and this is also a pulse. When the pulse is going up, or when the input is going up, we can see that the output is going down. So we can safely say the relationship between output and input is 180 degrees. That is, the output is 180 degrees out of phase with the input. And when the input goes down, we can see what is happening to the output. It is going up. Hence, we can say the input signal and the output signal are 180 degrees out of phase. Our output voltage there is the common emitter voltage, because the emitter is grounded, so the output is measured from zero to the collector. Hence, we can say this is the collector and emitter. So this is common emitter voltage, and it is the same as the output voltage. Our input is applied to the base, and this is the current limiting resistor RB, and this is the current limiting resistor RC. Our VCC is +5 volts, and the input signal has got an amplitude of 5 volts, and the same applies to the output. Please take note, this is a digital signal. We now want to analyze the behavior of a BJT switch when the input is high. And we are saying our input is +5 volts, meaning it is high. And what happens? This is going to turn on this transistor, because the input must be high for this transistor to conduct. So the base emitter junction is going to be forward biased. And when it is forward biased, we are going to have our collector current flowing through the resistor RC. And what happens? When this transistor is turned hard on, meaning that the input voltage is +5 volts, or the voltage is going to drop across the collector resistor RC, meaning that the voltage VC is going to be equal to zero, meaning that collector to emitter voltage, which is this voltage, collector to emitter voltage is equal to 0 volts when the transistor is turned hard on, meaning it is saturated. And under such a scenario, we are saying the transistor is acting as a switch, and this circuit is equivalent to this. And when it is acting as a a switch, it means that the voltage across it is equal to zero because it will be a wire, hence Vout is equal to zero. We know that when the switch is turned on, the voltage across it is equal to zero, please. And a saturated transistor behaves as a closed switch. This is our key statement. So we are saying the transistor is operating in the saturation region when input is high, that is, it has been turned hard on, meaning that collector to emitter voltage, which is the output voltage, it is equal to zero. We now want to turn the transistor off, just like we do an ordinary switch. And how do we proceed? Our input, which is the input voltage, Vin, must be equal to 0 volts. If our input is 0 volts, it means that nothing is going to flow through the collector resistor RC. And it means that there's not going to be any drop across RC, meaning that the voltage between the collector and emitter from there to there will be the same as the VCC. And we say this circuit is equivalent to this. And we are saying when the input is 0, the transistor will be off. And when the transistor, is off, it means that the voltage between the emitter and the collector will be equal to the supply voltage. And that is way how our ordinary switches operate. If you remember your previous lectures, we said that supply voltage develops across an open switch, hence the output voltage there is called to VCC. Hence the transistor is being represented by an off switch. And we are saying when Vin is equal to 0, the transistor is cut off. So we are saying a cutoff transistor behaves as an off or open switch. Hence collected emitter voltage would be equal to the supply voltage, and this is our output voltage. Guys, take note, and this is simple. Light emitting diode driver, you remember seeing this diagram when we covered or in the video presentation on optocouplers. And when the switch is on, it means that this transistor is turned on. And if the transistor is turned on, it is going to conduct. And when it conducts, this light emitting diode is going to turn on, hence it is going to emit light. And this means that the output voltage collected to emitter will be equal to zero. When the switch is off, it means that the collector to emitter voltage will be equal to the VCC voltage. So we are saying when the switch is off, base current is zero and collector current is off, meaning the diode is off, it does not emit light. When the switch is on, collector current flows through the diode, making it glow. And in this diagram, the LED is off when the switch off, and when the switch is turned on, we will have base current flowing, causing collector current to flow, thus glowing the light emitting diode. Light operated switch, guys, you remember your photodiode and phototransistor. Their resistance increases when light hits them or when there is incident light. So we want to see how we can use a transistor as a switch to turn on lights. And we are saying, let's proceed to the next diagram to see how a transistor can be used as a switch to turn on light. This is a photodiode and this is a phototransistor, and we are saying the photodiode phototransistor can be connected between 1 and 2. It's what we call the input connections. And when we have incident light, their conductivity is going to be improved. And when there is no light, their resistance is going to be very high, therefore restricting the flow of current. So we are saying during the day when there is light, the two are going to conduct when they are connected between the terminals 1 and 2. That's allowing current to flow, providing base current to transistor T1. This is going to turn on T2. Thus, this light is going to glow or to turn on. During the day, the resistance is very high, hence there is no base current, meaning that this transistor is off, meaning that no current is going to flow through the bulb, hence the light will be off. So, in other words, we are using this transistor as a switch to turn on this bulb. Transistor is an amplifier. We now know what a transistor is. What is an amplifier? An amplifier is a device that produces an output which is greater than its input. So we are saying a transistor can be used as a small signal amplifier as well as a large signal amplifier. A large signal amplifier is also known as a power amplifier. A small signal amplifier is an amplifier that only amplifies voltage. Whereas a large signal amplifier, also known as a power amplifier, is an amplifier that amplifies both voltage and current. So an amplifier is used to increase the amplitude or the size of the signal that is fed to its input signal, and it produces a large signal at its output that is greater than a signal at its input. And for our analysis in this presentation, we are going to assume a sinusoidal signal, and we are saying the output signal must maintain the frequency at the output. But you'll see that for a common emitter connected transistor, the phase may differ. And we are saying for a transistor to operate as an amplifier, it must be properly biased so that it operates in the active region. That is to say, base emitter junction must be forward biased while the collector base junction must be reverse biased. Please take note. This is a single stage transistor amplifier. Why? Because we only have got one input and one output and one BJT transistor, and single stage. And we are saying the transistor is connected in common emitter configuration, hence common emitter amplifier. This C stands for common emitter amplifier. We've got one supply voltage plus VCC, and this is our input signal that is fed to the base of the transistor. Capacitor C1 is a non-polarized capacitor, and what is its function? It blocks DC and also couples the input signal to the base of the transistor. R1, R2, and RE are biasing resistors. They determine the best Q point for the operation of the transistor. Then this is a current limiting resistor. Capacitor C2 also blocks DC so that it doesn't proceed to the output, which may be a speaker, and also it couples the output signal from the collector to the output device. And we are saying the input and output are out of phase by 180 degrees. Let's have a look at the input. This is in and output. As you can see, this is greater than this, since the transistor is acting as an amplifier, but the two are out of phase by 180 degrees. As the signal is going up, output is going down. As the input signal is going down, the output signal is going up, hence the 180 degrees phase shift. Please take note of the relationship between the input and the output. As I said, this is a sinusoidal signal, this is a sinusoidal signal, and the frequency is the same. Remember this circuit diagram, this is a voltage divider by a circuit. We've included the coupling capacitor C1, and it is polarized, and this is our generator. This is the input resistance of the generator, Vs. We've also included the coupling capacitor C2 at the output, and our load resistor RL. Guys, this is a typical circuit diagram of a single stage amplifier with a load connected RL. Please take note, might be asked in your exam to draw, and this is a typical diagram which you can draw. And we are saying, as we saw in the previous slide, the collector current IC varies above and below its Q point or the quiescent point, and it is in phase with the base current. But the collector to emitter voltages also varies, but out of phase by 180 degrees, above and below its Q point value. And we said it is out of phase with the base voltage VB as well as base current IB. And we are saying when one cycle of input is complete, we also have one cycle of output complete, and this means that the frequency is the same, but we know that output has a higher magnitude when compared to that of the input. So we must be able to describe we said R1, R2, and RE are biasing resistors. This is a coupling capacitor that couples the signal from the generator to the base of the transistor, but it also blocks DC so that we don't offset the Q point of this transistor. The same applies to C2. C2 couples the output signal from the single stage amplifier or from the collector of the single stage to the load resistor. This load resistor might be a speaker, and it blocks DC so that it doesn't destroy the speaker. And this is the supply voltage. This helps to reduce the effect of feedback due to the input signal. We are now analyzing the function of each component. As I said, R1, R2, and RE set the quiescent point or the base operating point for the common emitter amplifier. And I said C1 is a coupling capacitor, and it also blocks DC so that we maintain the correct bias conditions constant. Let's proceed to analyze the function of other components. The capacitor that is connected across the resistor RE is called emitter bypass capacitor because the AC signal is being made to bypass the resistor RE, and we are saying it is connected in parallel with the emitter resistor RE so that it provides low reactance path to an amplified AC signal. We know a capacitor is low reactance to AC signal but high reactance to, or in other words, infinite reactance to DC signal. What happens if we don't connect to the decoupling capacitor? It is called a decoupling capacitor because it provides a low reactance to AC signal. Its absence would cause a voltage drop due to the amplified AC signal across the emitter resistor RE, and this voltage drop is going to reduce the output voltage and gain of amplifier since it will provide negative feedback. Hence, it is a very important component, and as I said, it is a decoupling capacitor. It is not a coupling capacitor. Then C2 is the output coupling capacitor. It couples AC signal from the collector to the output load resistor, and it also blocks DC, thus passing only the amplified AC signal. We are going to revisit what we covered in transistor biasing techniques, and we said we've got what we call the Q point or the quiescent condition of the amplifier, and we are saying when there is no input signal at the base of the single stage amplifier transistor, only DC voltages are present in that circuit and no AC signal is present, and this is what we call zero signal or no signal condition, or simply quiescent condition for the amplifier. We are saying the transistor is at rest and we are having the following DC conditions: collector to emitter voltage, DC collector current IC, and DC base current IB. We are saying when we put the AC input signal, when we feed it to the transistor, it is going to be superimposed on the zero signal or no signal condition, also known as the quiescent condition, by applying an AC signal voltage at the input, and this is illustrated below. The IB is the base current. This is our base current and this is our time. And we are saying when we feed an AC signal, it is going to be superimposed as shown on the quiescent operating point, which is IBQ. This is quiescent base current as shown. IBQ is the quiescent base current, which is no load or no signal or zero signal base a current. So when we apply an AC signal, it is going to be superimposed as shown on the quiescent base current. We've got two signals, A and B, and this is the collector current. And this in dotted lines is what we call the quiescent collector current. This is the output current, and on B, we've got the output voltage, which is collector to emitter voltage. And this dotted line is what we call the quiescent collector to emitter voltage. So we are saying the collector current, the AC signal, which is the collector current, is going to superimpose itself on the quiescent collector current. The same applies to the collector to emitter voltage AC signal. It is going to superimpose itself on the quiescent collector to emitter voltage. And we are saying the output current is B times the base current, meaning that we've got, this is beta, is beta times the base current, and base current is the input current. So this is our output current, and this is for common emitter configuration. And we are saying it will vary sinusoidally. That is the output current around its quiescent collector current, and the same applies to the output voltage. This is a revision of Q point. If you still remember the previous lecture on transistor biasing techniques, and we are going to look at quiescent point, in short, Q point in detail. And we are saying the term quiescent point means quiet, still, inactive, or at rest. Therefore, the quiescent point is also known as the operating point or the biasing point, normally of a BJT transistor. And we are saying it is a point on the load line and it represents DC current through the transistor, which we are saying quiescent collector current as well as quiescent collector emitter voltage. And this is when no signal or when no AC signal is applied at the input of the transistor. And in short, a Q point represents DC bias conditions, and it has got two coordinates, quiescent collector current as well as quiescent collector to emitter voltage. These two define the Q point. And we are saying a DC load line joins IC such and VCE cutoff. And we are saying it is a set of infinite number of operating points, and the user or designer can choose any point along the load line as the operating point. And the choice of the point depends on the application. And for a transistor as an amplifier, we choose the center of the load line. But for transistor as a switch, we choose the point near saturation and the point near cutoff for to represent the transistor when it is on and off respectively. And as I said, the coordinates of the Q point are quiescent collector current and quiescent collector to emitter voltage. We are again revisiting the load line superimposed on the collector curves. These are our collector curves, and this is our load line as shown. And this point is the center of the load line. So we are saying this is our base current, which is the input to the transistor. This is our base current, and this point is the quiescent base current, which is this point, and it's 30 microamps as shown. And we are saying if this is our input, we know that the input base current and the output collector current are in phase as shown, but the output voltage, which is quiescent collector voltage, is out of phase with the input. So we are saying when the Q point is on the center of the load line, we have got an unclipped output current as well as an unclipped output voltage. Hence we are saying for linear operation of a common emitter amplifier, the quiescent point must be at the center of the load line, so that we've got an undistorted output current as well as an undistorted output voltage. And we are saying the input and output are out of phase by 180 degrees. You can see the input and you can see the output. This is the relationship between the input current and the output voltage. I said for a transistor to operate, as the Q point must be at the center of the load line. We now want to demonstrate what happens if we choose a Q point that is near cutoff. So we are saying Q point close to cutoff, and this is the Q point that we have chosen, and this is our cutoff point. This is our input signal. As you can see, it is IBQ, which is quiescent base current. And this is an AC signal that has been superimposed on the quiescent base current, because the quiescent base current is the dotted part. So we have got two output signals, collector current as well as collector to emitter voltage. And we are saying when the Q point is towards cutoff, this part is going to be clipped. It is going to be distorted. This is not distorted, but it is limited in amplitude. Hence, we are saying distortion in the collector current waveform due to a Q point that is near cutoff. We've removed the negative or part of the negative half cycle. But because the input and output are out of phase, please take note that we have removed part of the positive half cycle. We have clipped it off, and we are saying the output is distorted. It has been clipped off. It no longer has the same shape as the input signal, which is this signal. Hence, we are saying for a transistor to operate as an amplifier, the Q point must never be near cutoff but at the center of the load line to avoid distortion. Distorted music is not appetizing to the. An analysis of a Q point that is near or above the Q point. This is the Q point that is near saturation. This is saturation and this is cutoff. And we are saying if we are very close to saturation, this is the effect on the output signal. This is our input AC signal that is superimposed on the quiescent AC current, which is this, the dotted line, and we've got a positive and negative half cycles. Because this is our cue point, the output must be above and below the cue point, but this is the effect. Because this is close to saturation, it means that the bottom negative half is going to be clipped off. In other words, it is going to be removed, meaning that the output signal, AC signal, is a distorted one. But we have on the voltage, we have removed the bottom negative half. Why? Because the input and output are out of phase. But because this is in phase with this, we are going to remove part of the positive half cycle. And why? Because of the position of the cue point. This point must align. It determines the maximum positive half cycle. This is all going to be removed. Hence, point that is towards the saturation point is not ideal, because it is going to remove part of the music, part of the bass. Hence, it will be a distorted output, and it's not palatable to our ears. Hence, this is an illustration when the cue point is moved towards saturation as opposed to the cue point. As you saw, or as you can see, we've got a distorted output current and a distorted output voltage. Guys, for a transistor as an amplifier, this is what we need. The cue point must be at the center of the load line. This is our load line, and this is almost its center. And we are saying this is our input signal, and it is superimposed on quiescent base current IBQ, right? So if our cue point is at the center, let's have a look at our output current. This is our output current, and as we can see, we have got a good positive half cycle as well as a good negative half cycle, which means there is no distortion in the output signal. As for the output voltage, as we can see, the input and output are out of phase, but there is no distortion on the output voltage. Why? Because our signal can afford to go to its maximum negative and to its maximum positive, though it is inverted, meaning that there is no distortion on the output. Hence, we can say for a transistor to operate as an amplifier, the cue point must be at the center of the load line as shown. As you can see, a transistor has got three regions of operation. This is the cutoff region, then we've got the saturation region, and this is our active region, and that is where we have our cue point. So that is it insofar as transistor as an amplifier is concerned. So in this presentation, we have looked at transistor as a switch and also transistor as an amplifier. And I hope you have enjoyed. If you haven't subscribed, guys, I beg you, don't forget to just hit the subscribe button. Simba Kumshand. Guys, time flies. We've come to the end of our presentation on transistor as a switch and also as an amplifier. And I hope you have enjoyed what I have provided for you. You must be able to describe. You also must be able to illustrate. Also, guys, if you haven't subscribed, don't forget to hit the subscribe button. You may also like, may also comment, and you may also share.